Well, a very warm welcome, everybody, to Chatham House this evening, especially to Prime Minister of Ukraine, Oleksiy Honcharuk, who's here for the first time, I think. If I can just introduce myself, I'm Robert Brinkley. I chair the Ukraine Forum here at Chatham House, which we set up in the middle of 2015 to discuss and pay attention to Ukraine on its own merits, not as seen through the eyes of other states. And we're going to have another all-day conference on Ukraine with the slightly Dickensian title of Ukraine Great Expectations here in London, here in Chatham House, on Thursday the 5th of December. This meeting is on the record and is being live streamed, and you can, if you wish, comment by Twitter using the hashtag CHEvents and at CH Ukraine Forum. But please make sure now that your mobile phones are turned to silent. Today is the 6th anniversary of the start of the Revolution of Dignity, or the Euromaidan, which was a real watershed event. The modern history of Ukraine divides into before or after that revolution. And just this year, in 2019 in Ukraine, the people of Ukraine elected a new president, Volodymyr Zelenskyy, who had no previous political experience. And in a free and fair election, he won 73% of the votes. 73%. So Ukraine's neighbors, please take note. The people of Ukraine then elected a new parliament, giving the president's party, Servant of the People, an absolute majority of seats. And this is the first time that that has happened since Ukraine's independence in 1991. So there's been a change of generation in power in Ukraine, although this may tell you more about me than it does about the new generation in Ukraine. The average age of members of parliament is now 41 years. That's 7 years younger than in the previous parliament. The average age of the cabinet of ministers is 39. So it is fitting that the new prime minister, Oleksiy Honcharuk, is at 35 years old, the youngest prime minister in independent Ukraine. He is a lawyer who spent more than 10 years in legal practice. He won a reputation as a strong fighter for the rights of the business community. From 2015, he headed the Better Regulation Delivery Office, a non-governmental organization. And in that capacity, he stimulated a veritable bonfire of the regulations. Some 1,000 regulations were cancelled. He was also an external advisor to First Deputy Prime Minister Stepan Kubiv, who was responsible for economic development and trade. The Prime Minister is going to speak to you for about 15 minutes and then take questions. And this meeting will finish at 8 o'clock. Prime Minister.
Ladies and gentlemen, dear Ambassador Brinkley, thank you very much for such honor to speak to you. I was informed that in this auditory there are a lot of friends of Ukraine. Is it true? Yes. It's a very good idea to speak with the friends in London. If you'd be so kind to allow me to use some notes, because it will be my first big speech in English, so I will use it sometimes. First of all, for us, it's very special day, because 6 years ago, I was on Maidan with another people, with my friends, and we fight for European values. And 6 years ago, Ukraine's European pass was chosen by millions of people on this Euromaidan, and for us it was a revolution of dignity. And now, as you see, I'm honored to lead the new government, and you can be sure that we will continue this direction. Ukraine will move into the Europe, into the NATO standards, based on our values, of course. But this choice didn't come without a price, and you know about it. Russia occupied Donbass and annexed Crimea, and we still have war in our east lands. Russia is imposing aggression in all spheres, and President Zelenskyy is doing his best to bring some peace into these lands. And my first message is that, from my point of view, it's all this conflict, this situation is not an issue only for Ukraine. It's an issue, it's a challenge, big challenge for all the world. And it's very important for whole world order. Of course, we in Ukraine have a lot of different things to be done, and I call it our homework, and I'll try to describe some ideas what we are going to do next in coming years in our government. First of all, of course, we should create some level playing field. It's very important for attracting investments, and Ukraine needs more investments, it's true. We will start, we already started, from our tax and customs services. Right now in Ukraine, the head of the state tax service and state customs service are young, high professional, and very good people without any vested interests behind. And I believe, I'm sure, that they will create some level playing field in a sense of some tax regulations and customs regulations. Tax reform is important to ensure clear rules for business. It's absolutely understandable. That's why I'm speaking about it maybe as about priority. The second very important priority for us is digitalization. It's absolutely understandable that in the modern world, in the 21st century, the government, the state, just couldn't be efficient without innovations, without ITs. In Ukraine, we have a great IT sphere, a lot of very highly talented people in this sphere. And we are going to, and we already attracted them into our government, into our team. We have a very strong and very qualified team, IT team, IT, a lot of actually IT teams inside our government. We need to bring some, to create some efficient and good solutions. We need a good data. And frankly speaking, we still have no enough data to do it. So right now we are working on collecting some data and connecting and gathering all our registers, databases, and so on and so forth to make our state more efficient. We still have in Ukraine a lot of post-Soviet barriers, limits, and absolutely doubtless we should cancel them. I speak, first of all, about land moratorium. I know that the land reform is a very complicated topic in our society, but we are very we are standing on the position that we should provide this reform, first of all, and nearest in coming months. It's very important signal, not only because the land reform, from my point of view, is a signal to all over the world that in Ukraine, the real, the complicated reforms could be provided. It could happen. We have a lot of different limits in some other spheres. For example, we have a lot of limits if you're speaking about the movement of capital. We have a lot of limits in our labor regulations because they was created, they were created in the middle of last century in the Soviet Union. And of course, it's absolutely unacceptable to keep all these rules in 21st century. We should simplify them, and we are ready to simplify them. One more important topic for Ukraine, of course, it's a corruption. And we are ready to fight against corruption, and we already do it. We'll start from decreasing the level of influence and participation of our state, of our government in an economy, and we are ready for the big privatization. We already prepared more than 500 different assets to be sold, to be moved into some efficient owners next year. We have very good professional, young, talented manager in our state property fund. This is a state body, main state body in Ukraine, responsible for the privatization. That's why I have any doubts that the big privatization is possible now in Ukraine. Another issue is a monopolies. Of course, monopolies, it's very bad for fair competition. Energy sphere and infrastructure sphere has a lot of monopolies right now in Ukraine. And the need of reform in the energy sector is maybe one of the most reform we are going to provide next in coming months. Last week, actually, the president signed the law, maybe you heard about it, the law about unbundling of Naftogaz. It's a very complicated decision, was the very complicated decision. But right now, we almost have the independent operator for our gas transport system. And for us, it's a very good step, it's a very good achievement. And a very big achievement, because it was not very easy to adopt this law and all these sub-laws. Of course, let us be clear that all these reforms and initiatives will not succeed unless they are supported by the new strong institutions. We understand it. And one such institution is the judiciary. Judiciary reform has not yet successful, enough successful in Ukraine, but last half of year, last months, I believe we have a great progress here. First of all, for example, the High Anti-Corruption Court has launched and it already works. And I have no any doubts that the judges in this court are highly professional and well-trusted persons in our society, and they will do their best to bring our judiciary into another level. Of course, there are a lot of different another activities already done last couple of months, but there are a lot of very important institutions should be supported in Ukraine, such as Anti-Monopoly Committee and such as National Bank of Ukraine. From the start, we told that National Bank is independent, and of course, we should support it, this independence, because it creates a very important base for macroeconomic stability. And actually, right now, of course, we should improve their capacity, we should support them, we should protect them, but right now, I can already tell that National Bank and Anti-Monopoly Committee are capable enough to make their job well. Finally, today, my government is working on the transformation, which by its scale and complexity is unprecedented. And I think we have very good macroeconomic situation in Ukraine. As I already told today, at last two quarters, our economy grows more than 4%. And we expect that all these reforms we are going to provide next year will speed up this growth next year. And from my point of view, it's a great time for all investors to come to Ukraine to reach a lot of money, because our government is going to decrease the level of risks and issue for them. Our government is the youngest government in the history of our country. Our parliament and our president, the youngest in the history of our country. What it means? For us, it means not that our country leads by some just another people. We changed the generation in our country, which leading this country. And we are absolutely open for a new, for challenges of this world. And for us, of course, it's very important to have support of this modern world. We understand that the main resources is in this 21st century's world is the trust. That's why for us it's very important to have a trust from you, and you can be sure that we will use this trust to make a great changes of our country and to make more people happy in this world. Thank you very much for your attention, and I'm ready to answer your question.
Well, Prime Minister, if I may, I'll start off the questioning and then we'll open it up for the audience. You talked there about creating a level playing field. You said that your government supports the independence of the National Bank of Ukraine, and you talked about gaining the trust of the outside world, which is so important. How can your government demonstrate to the outside world that you're working for Ukraine as a whole and not in the interest of one or other big business figure. And I think, judging by what the IMF and other international donors have been saying, and I don't see a great rush of investors so far, they still need to be convinced. How are you going to convince them?
Thank you for such a complicated question. If you allow me, I will switch on my native tongue, and I'll ask to help with the translation, because I want to be as honest as clear as possible. It's still complicated. Ми з самого початку своїми діями, реальними практичними діями, показуємо, що цей уряд найбільш незалежний від всіх груп впливу.
With all our deeds and with all the actions we've taken so far, we're trying to show that we remain to be the most independent government ever in Ukraine.
Not trying to show, but we are already showed. Це дуже просто побачити, якщо подивитися на то, хто є уряд. Хто входить до уряду?
That's easily visible if you just take a look at who's part of the government.
Наш міністр економіки – це людина, яка має закордонну освіту, є професором в американському університеті.
For instance, our economic minister received his education overseas, and he is a professor of one of the US universities.
Наш міністр юстиції – це людина, яка працювала в Світовому банку і має освіту юриста, яку вона здобула в Лондоні.
And actually, a minister of justice actually had been working for the World Bank for a lot of time and received education in London.
І так можна говорити захопливо про майже кожного міністра.
And I can be talking about every minister in our government with the same passion.
Це нові люди з абсолютно іншими цінностями, які орієнтовані на те, щоб змінити країну і світ.
These are the people with absolutely different values and are eager and ready to work to change the country for the better.
Такі самі люди зараз очолюють один за одним різні державні органи.
People of the same professional level are now leading the key Ukrainian government agencies.
Через прозорі конкурси.
And they're normally hired through transparent competition.
І це вже дає результати.
And this already is producing results.
Наприклад, на минулому тижні парламент ухвалив бюджет нашої країни на наступний рік.
For instance, last week our parliament already approved our country's next year's budget.
Це рекордно рано в нашій країні ухвалений бюджет.
And that's probably a record that they've made in terms of passing the budget for the next year that early.
Тобто зазвичай бюджет в Україні ухвалювався вночі, перед Новим роком, а зараз він абсолютно спокійно був ухвалений буквально там за декілька днів роботи.
Well, normally it had been happening for nights long, and they had been approving this budget probably a night before the new year. And last week, it just takes several days, let's say, to have the budget completely approved.
Це говорить про те, якщо на нього подивитися, це говорить про те, що там всередині ніде не заховані ніякі інтереси.
And what it means, actually, is that when you take a look at that budget, you may not see any vested interest encrypted into this budget.
І це дуже злить окремі групи впливу.
And that makes different influential groups feel very bad.
Тому, до речі, багато з них дуже активними є в публічній сфері.
That's why many of them are now continuously speaking publicly a lot.
Ви можете побачити їх інтерв'ю в великих засобах масової інформації, навіть закордонних.
You can see many of their interviews that are now broadcasted by many different outstanding TV stations and other media.
А це показує лише те, що вони хочуть здаватися впливом, а насправді їх вплив зменшується.
But this only demonstrates that those people still try to keep pretend they are still influential, which is no longer the case.
Тому головною відповіддю на те, як ми збираємося показувати, що ми незалежні, що ми будемо працювати принципово інакше, є те, що ми вже робимо.
So that's why we're trying to show that we're absolutely independent. We want to work and we do work absolutely in a different manner, which we will obviously continue to do.
Цей уряд дуже орієнтується на президента, про якого сьогодні сказав пан амбасадор.
Of course, this government is pretty much reliant on the president, which was already mentioned.
А президент відповідно орієнтується на людей, які його обрали. 73% – це величезна підтримка.
And the president, in his turn, is primarily led by his voters. And as you've heard already, there were 73% of voters who supported the president.
Тому в діях нашого уряду ви не побачите дій на користь тої чи іншої окремої групи.
So in anything our government has been and will be doing, you will hardly see any kind of attempt to appease any vested or influential groups out there.
Все, що ми робимо, спрямовано на те, щоб в Україні з'являлося rule of law, чесна конкуренція, правосуддя та відкриті кордони.
So anything we're doing is primarily focused on establishing a proper rule of law, also fair competition, access to justice, and transparent and open borders.
You referred just now to the Parliament passing the budget in record time. I think the Parliament, with this big majority of the ruling party, has been breaking other records as well for not just the speed, but the quantity of legislation that's been going through. But that in turn, I think, has raised some questions within Ukraine. Has there been enough time for consultation with interested parties? Are mistakes being made? Are you putting more value on speed and quantity and not enough value on the quality of legislation? How would you answer that?
Завжди має бути баланс.
There must be balance everywhere and always.
І тому у нас в Україні є такий вислів, я його дуже люблю, що написаний не тобою закон завжди трошки сируватий.
You know, there is a saying in Ukrainian which says, if the law hasn't been produced by yourself, it always seems to be bad for you.
І тому можна критикувати абсолютно все, але загалом, на мою думку, якість рішень, які приймаються, ми будемо судити по наслідках.
Of course, anything can be criticized as much as possible. But we're going to judge in terms of the quality of those regulations and laws passed after they're enforced, and we're going to see the effect of them.
Тому я вірю, що ми не маємо зволікати ні хвилини, не втрачати ні хвилини для того, щоб змінювати країну. Дуже багато роботи ще потрібно зробити.
So I must say we shouldn't waste a single minute and continue the change process and change things in the country as much as that can be done so far.
Але в чому ви праві, що нашою головною цінністю, яку ми зараз намагаємося створити, є довіра.
But you rightly mentioned that the biggest value we need to create right now is really trust.
А для того, щоб будувати довіру, потрібно, щоб тебе розуміли, щоб не боялися змін.
And to build this credibility and trust, one has to make sure you actually don't fear things. And you need to actually move ahead and be transparent enough.
Тому, звичайно, нам потрібен певний час на цей діалог. От такий баланс ми намагаємося кожен раз знайти.
Of course, it takes time to build and then maintain this dialogue. And that's exactly what we're trying to do.
Коли ти робиш багато змін, намагаєшся змінити багато речей одночасно, звичайно, будуть тут помилки.
Of course, when you are making a lot of changes at a time, you can't avoid mistakes.
Але ми готові приймати, визнавати ці помилки і виправляти їх разом з тими, кому вони шкодять.
But we are ready to accept that we made a mistake and acknowledge them and be working closely together to help them correct it.
І я думаю, що це також може будувати довіру.
And I think this is another thing that can help build more trust.
Let's ask the audience for questions. There are microphones coming round, so when I pick you for a question, please can you keep your hand up so the person with the microphone can see you. One here, please. And when you get the microphone, can you please give your name and, if you wish, your affiliation? And please keep your questions nice and short so that we can get lots of people in.
Thank you very much, Prime Minister. I'm Mathieu Boulleg. I'm a research fellow at the Russian Eurasia Programme, and I've been working specifically on civil society resilience in Ukraine with my colleague, Oleksiy Honcharuk from the Ukraine Forum. How do you see the place of civil society in the agenda of reform, as civil society has always been a driver for change and reform in Ukraine? And if I can ask a very short provocative question, you've been speaking about a new generation of young educated Ukrainians in politics with new values. Does that include the current Minister of Interior, Arsen Avakov? Thank you.
Я переконаний, що роль громадянського суспільства в Україні є вирішальною.
I'm convinced that the role played by the civil society in Ukraine is immense and extraordinary.
Я почав сьогодні свою промову з того, що згадав 6 років назад ми з друзями фактично були учасниками Революції Гідності.
I started my speech tonight by actually recalling those events back 6 years ago when myself and friends of mine were actual participants of that Revolution of Dignity.
І роль громадянського суспільства в цих подіях, вона була вирішальною. Справді, це і було громадянське суспільство.
And the civil society's role in those events cannot be overestimated. I think their role was very decisive at that point.
Ми зараз кожну свою дію намагаємося звіряти з інститутами громадянського суспільства.
Whatever action we are taking at the moment, we are trying to coordinate them properly with the civil society organizations.
І це не дуже складно, тому що ми є, ну, однодумцями, ми сповідуємо одні цінності.
And that's not very difficult indeed, because we are like-minded people together, and we have the same values we want to follow.
Тому я міг би сказати, що в цьому уряді навіть є багато людей, які досі асоціюють себе з громадянським суспільством.
And I think there are still many people in our government who still think that they are part of civil society, at least that's what they think about themselves.
Відповідаючи на друге питання про міністра внутрішніх справ.
In answering the second question of yours regarding our Minister of Interior.
У нас є два міністра, які залишились з минулого попереднього уряду. Це міністр фінансів і міністр внутрішніх справ.
Actually, we have two government ministers who actually were in the previous government as well. And I'm talking here about the Interior Minister and the Finance Minister.
Коли це рішення приймалося, ми виходили з того, що важливо, щоб силове відомство, яке контролює Національну гвардію, поліцію, ну, тобто фактично сили, які підтримують порядок на вулиці, і людина, яка фактично є основою для фінансової системи, які зараз точно були частиною уряду для того, щоб якби в цей складний період часу не завдавати додаткової шкоди.
So we actually decided to keep those professional people on the one hand at the ministry that oversees the law enforcement institutions like the National Guard and the police, as well as another minister who actually laid a good foundation for the Ukraine's financial system to keep them in this not a very easy time for Ukraine.
І моя головна відповідь тут полягає в тому, що ми дивимося зараз дуже уважно на те, що власне відбувається в кожному з міністерств і намагаємося оцінювати дії кожного міністра і по цих діях судити про те, що відбувається.
And actually, we are looking closely at what every ministry is doing, and we are judging only by their accomplishments and deeds.
Okay, next question. Lady over there, please.
Prime Minister, my name is Latika Burke. I'm a journalist with the Sydney Morning Herald in Australia. Could you please explain to the victims of MH17 why your government agreed to send Volodymyr Semak back to Russia in the recent prisoner swap out of the reach of investigators ahead of the trial next year?
Я вважаю, що це трагедія, яка трапилась, безумовно, з вини Російської Федерації.
I think this tragedy happened, and that's the fault of the Russian Federation.
І звичайно, всі винні в цій трагедії мають бути покарані.
And definitely all the guilty ones must be punished.
Що я хотів би, щоб ми всі зрозуміли? Для нас всі ці події, всі ці трагедії є частиною одної великої історії.
I just want everybody to understand here. All those developments of the past and all those tragedies is a big bad thing that had happened to Ukraine.
Історії, в якій одна велика країна, яка інвестує мільярди доларів в зброю, в озброєння, в те, щоб посилити свій військовий потенціал, атакує свого сусіда.
And this whole story is about a large neighboring country that is investing billions and billions into building more military capacity and presence, into their arms and weapons, to actually fight against the civilized world.
Для нас це історія про порушення світового порядку.
It is a story for ourselves about the international and global order was breached.
І цей порядок має бути відновлений через санкції, через координовані дії всіх людей цивілізованого світу.
And actually this order must be restored through sanctions and also coordinated action of all the important actors around the globe.
Тому, оцінюючи кожну конкретну дію, нам потрібно пам'ятати про ширший контекст.
And therefore, actually, when we talk about any single event or something happening, we need to understand the broader context.
І я переконаний в тому, що коментуючи цей загальний контекст, нам потрібно розуміти і нам потрібно навчитися називати речі своїми іменами.
And you know, in understanding this general context, we need to learn how to call a spade a spade.
Thank you. Gentleman there at the back of the front section.
Hi, Ned Sedgwick, freelance Chatham House member. I'm just wondering what you're doing to ensure that there is no repeat of the kind of 1990s of oligarchies taking massive amounts of land with the new land reforms. They seem to have been passed quite quickly, and I'd just be interested in your reasoning for how quickly they were passed and the insurances against big business taking that land and that amazing economic resource from smaller to mid-level farmers.
Це дуже актуальне питання для України.
It's a really relevant question for Ukraine at the moment.
Я вважаю, що для України взагалі земельна реформа, взагалі створення ринку землі – це величезний крок вперед.
And I think this entire land reform and creating the land market is a big step towards the Ukraine's reform process.
Тому що, відверто, якщо говорити, то в Україні існує де-факто ринок землі. Просто він сірий, він такий напівлегальний.
In fact, when we try to talk about the existing land market in Ukraine today, it's still there, it's already functioning, although it is grey sometimes.
І тому фактично, якщо подивитися на суть того, що відбувається, то держава просто обмежує простих людей, власників своїх активів, власників землі, в тому, щоб розпоряджатися своїми правами.
And the bad thing about it is, without this reform, the state kind of limits those small and medium landowners of their opportunities out there in the market.
Тому для нас ця реформа не про те, як перерозподілити землю там одних на користь інших. Це реформа про те, як відновити справедливість, як перестати забороняти людям розпоряджатися своєю власністю.
And for us, this reform is not an attempt to actually somehow redistribute this land resources and take it from some people and give it away to some other people. This is more about restoring justice and actually stop keeping away from legitimate access to these resources.
Звичайно, ми модель ще дискутуємо.
Of course, the model is still under discussion.
Звичайно, різні види бізнесу ще можуть думати про те, як адаптувати свої моделі під нову можливу модель ринку.
Of course, businesses still have to think about adapting their business models to this newly emerging land market.
І до того, як парламент ухвалить фінальне рішення по земельній реформі, ще пройде певний час.
And of course, certain time will still pass until the parliament will already make the ultimate decision about the land reform and the land resources at all.
Але наш уряд точно буде стояти на тому, щоб не створювати якихось штучних преференцій для великого бізнесу. Навпаки, ми вже своїми діями робимо зворотні.
But our government will be doing everything possible not to give any preferences to large businesses to actually be taking all those land resources. On the contrary, we're trying hard to actually create this level playing field for medium and small businesses.
Lady here, please.
Thank you, Prime Minister, for your speech.
Could you introduce yourself?
Yes, I'm Alina Slusarchuk, Morgan Stanley, head of CMIA team and Ukraine economist. I have two questions, if I may. One is, okay, just one. We have the IMF mission in town again, and it left in September. We were, to be honest, a bit disappointed. So the one question is, can it leave without the deal for the second time? Because for the second time, it would be much more negative signal to the markets. Thanks.
Місія МВФ зараз в Києві. І прямо зараз вони працюють з нашими колегами в уряді.
The IMF mission is currently being in Kyiv at the moment, and they are now working closely with our government colleagues there.
Ви прекрасно знаєте, що я не можу коментувати за місію або не можу наперед говорити про те, чи буде досягнена домовленість чи ні.
You clearly understand that I cannot comment here for the mission itself, and I cannot tell you in advance what's going to be the outcome ultimately.
Але я хочу сказати тут дві важливі речі.
But here are the two important things that I would like to mention here.
Перше, для нас МВФ – це співпраця з ними, це не про гроші, це про довіру.
First of all, our cooperation with IMF is not that much about money, but it's a lot about trust.
І перше моє повідомлення, я не маю жодного сумніву, що з кожним днем роботи з фондом довіра між нами зростає.
And I have no doubt whatsoever that every next day that we continue working with the mission, our credibility and trust grow.
І друге моє повідомлення полягає в тому, що якщо подивитися на історію роботи українських урядів з місіями МВФ, ще ніколи не було такого, щоб після обрання нового уряду протягом місяця місія їхала з staff level agreement.
And you know, if you track back the entire Ukraine's independent history, and a history of all the governments. It was never a case when, for instance, the IMF mission would come after the new government came to office. And over a month's time, they left with total success.
Тому більше того, було багато випадків, коли для того, щоб завершити переговори з Міжнародним валютним фондом, це займало і півроку, і більше.
Moreover, some of those negotiations sometimes took 6 months and even longer.
Наш уряд веде перемовини з МВФ, я не знаю, 10 тижнів.
I think it's been 10 weeks since our government started talks with the IMF so far.
Тому в будь-якому разі ніякої трагедії я не бачу.
So I cannot see any tragedy here yet.
Але звичайно, ми розраховуємо на те, що домовленість буде досягнена про, ну, на рівні на staff level рівні максимальну швидкість.
But I'm sure the staff level arrangements and actually agreements will be reached very soon.
Yeah, here, please.
Mr. Prime Minister, Tim Ash from Blue Bay. Firstly, congratulations, because I think your programme is innovative, very ambitious, and things like land reform that for 30 years in a country like Ukraine with the best soil in Europe, you know, this can be transformational and, you know, privatization. You mentioned digitalization and also for being very ambitious. I mean, your 40% over 5-year growth target is absolutely achievable, you know, if you follow through with land reform. And also if you deliver on what you said previously in terms of rule of law. But my question, I guess, and I'm sure you know what question I'm going to ask, right? So the question is, on PrivatBank, which I think is the number one issue for investors, it's the number one issue for the IMF. What's the strategy now if the Ukrainian courts rule for denationalization? The second question, I guess, is, you know, there has been talk about compromises and deals been done with oligarchs around the banking crisis of 2015 to 2017. You know, what kind of deals could be done? And then a very specific question. I mean, in relation to the PrivatBank case, there is obviously a London legal case, and it's been really specific about what happened. I mean, it's really interesting for everyone in the room to actually read the documentation. But if that case rules that there was actual fraud, a 5.5 billion fraud, is it at all possible that a deal could be done with that particular oligarch?
Thank you.
Дякую за це питання.
I thank you for this question.
Тімоті, ви могли його не задавати, я міг би його вгадати.
Timothy, you shouldn't have asked it. I could have guessed it.
По PrivatBank'у. Перше. У нас є дуже чітке розуміння у мене, у президента, у уряду, що кейс PrivatBank'у є показовим про Україну для всього світу.
I'm very sure that, and I'm sure about this, and the president is as well as our government, that the PrivatBank case is really outstanding for the rest of the world as well, not only for Ukraine.
Тому, звичайно, ми стоїмо на тому, що ні цей банк, ні кошти з нього не повинні бути повернені попереднім акціонерам.
That's why we stand firmly on such an opinion that neither the bank itself nor the money should be returned to the former investors.
Це наша чітка позиція.
And this is our clear position.
І ми будемо робити все від нас залежне для того, щоб ця позиція вона була захищена.
And we are going to be doing everything possible for that kind of opinion and our position to be well established and protected.
Якщо ви мене питаєте про суди,
if you're asking about the courts,
а я маю певний досвід роботи з судами,
and you know, I've had experience of working with courts a lot,
то я можу сказати, що стратегія в кожному конкретному випадку, незалежно від того, яким би могло би бути рішення суду, вона може бути різною.
And of course, strategies, notwithstanding different rulings that the court can make, can be different.
Але ви можете бути впевнені, що у нас є стратегії, ми готові до будь-якого розвитку подій, яким би вони не були.
But you've got to be sure that we have the strategy, if not strategies, to actually give a proper response to whatever situation that might happen.
В будь-якому разі, уряд України і команда президента буде робити все від нас залежне для того, щоб цей приклад став таким сигналом про те, що в Україні все змінилося.
And actually our government as well as the president, I'm sure, will be doing everything possible for this case to be a real signal from Ukraine that Ukraine has really changed.
There's a lady second row from the back.
Prime Minister, you mentioned Ukraine.
Could you introduce yourself, please?
Sorry. You mentioned Ukraine still in war. Oh, sorry. Eugenia Klotchko, Novy Knoll. You mentioned Ukraine still in war with Russia, but however, Ukraine resumed supplies of commercial electricity from Russia. Does it mean Ukraine ready for to go softer sanctions against Russia, or how Deputy Prime Minister mentioned there's some cancellation, some sanctions in January in next year? What do you think?
Ukraine is still at war with Russia, but it is taking electricity from Russia. Does this mean you're going soft on sanctions?
Дивіться, Україна має дуже чітку стратегію в сфері енергетики.
Ukraine has a really straightforward energy strategy.
Між нашим системним оператором, який керує всією нашою енергосистемою, та системними операторами окремими в Європі, підписаний меморандум про те, що українська енергосистема вона має бути інтегрована з європейською до 2023 року.
So our principal major, if not to say main, system operator in Ukraine has signed the memorandum with most of the European system operators that the Ukrainian grid will be absolutely and completely integrated with the European one by 2023.
Що це означає на практиці? Це означає, що для того, щоб інтегруватися до європейської енергетичної мережі, нам потрібно спочатку від'єднатися від російської, з якою наша енергетична система традиційно, історично досі пов'язана.
And what this actually means for Ukraine's power grid to be integrated with that of the European Union, we obviously need to be disconnected from the grid with the power with the Russian Federation. With which it had been historically connected, as you may probably know.
Потім якийсь час профункціонувати окремо, індивідуально.
Then, over time, it has to stay in function on its own, by itself.
І лише потім, після того, як інфраструктура буде створена, інтегруватися повністю до європейської системи.
And only then after, when the infrastructure is properly built, then it can be integrated with the EU power grid.
І це означає, що... І це насправді наші дійсні плани, і ми будемо намагатися по них рухатись.
And these are the plans we have, and we will be doing everything possible to deliver on the plan.
Але, як я вже сказав, історично українська енергетична мережа і російська енергетична мережа, вони пов'язані між собою.
But like I said, historically, the Ukrainian and Russian power grids are always connected.
І протягом всього цього часу у нас постійно відбуваються перетоки електроенергії.
And you know, during all those times, we normally have those ups and downs in the power supplies.
Тому ці операції вони з'явилися не вчора і не позавчора.
So those actually energy supplies and power supplies were not just happening yesterday.
І цей відсоток цих операцій він абсолютно незначний для українського великого ринку.
And if you take the real share of those, so to say, supplies in the entire Ukraine's grid capacities, that's really minute.
Тому проста відповідь на ваше питання, без технічних деталей, полягає в тому, що ми, як країна, будемо прагнути максимально швидко від'єднати нашу систему від російської і приєднатися до європейської. Це, ну, той план, який ми маємо.
So to give you a quick answer to that question, actually, Ukraine will be doing everything possible and as swiftly as possible to get disconnected from the Russian Federation's power grid and be connected as soon as possible to that of EU.
The lady at the back, please.
Hi, Julia McFarlane, ABC News. Prime Minister, welcome to London and thank you for your comments. I wanted to ask, President Zelensky reacted to some comments that Kolomoisky made recently about Ukraine needing to turn back to Russia. The president said that it was his wish that elected officials determine Ukrainian policy and not oligarchs and businessmen. I wanted to ask, how is that going so far? And one example, I mean, Vitaly Klitschko, Zelensky wanted Klitschko out of office, but he's managed to use his influence to hang in his job. So I just wanted to ask how that challenge is going. Can this new generation of leadership really shake off the old guard?
Я вже сказав про те, що ні на президента, ні на уряд олігархи впливу не мають.
Like I already said, actually, there is no influence on the president, nor there is any on government from oligarchs.
Але при цьому в Україні є багато груп впливу, багато впливових людей, які якби мають право, які виступають, які говорять з засоби масової інформації.
However, there are so many groups of influence in Ukraine and very influential individuals who actually use every attempt to speak up publicly and make their declarations. That's all natural.
Я не думаю, що я повинен коментувати висловлювання окремих таких людей.
I don't think I'm in a position to share my comments about opinions of those people.
Від себе я можу сказати, що я абсолютно переконаний в тому, що президент який сьогодні є в Україні, це така безпрецедентна можливість для нашої країни, тому що це є чесний, порядний, професійний чоловік, який хоче найкращого для нашої країни.
And I'm sure that this president we have today is a very honest, diligent and professional person, and this is exactly a very good opportunity for our country these days.
І я не маю жодного сумніву, що він поставить в будь-якій ситуації інтереси держави вище, ніж будь-який індивідуальний інтерес.
And I have no doubt whatsoever that in any situation the president will always put the interest of the state much higher than any other interests out there.
A question in the front here, please. Gentleman here.
Prime Minister, thank you. Robert Gardner, Chatham House. Prime Minister, thank you very much for your talk and good luck to you. Burisma, I wonder if you could comment on, is there an investigation going on? If so, what about? And can you also comment about your relationship with the American administration?
Можливо, я про щось не знаю.
Maybe I don't know something.
Дякую вам за ваше побажання.
But thanks very much for your wishes.
Можливо, я неправильно зрозумів ваше питання.
Maybe I just didn't get your question right.
Is there an investigation into Burisma and what is the relationship, your government with the US administration?
I didn't catch the name of the company. Я думаю, що у мене немає якоїсь деталізованої інформації про це розслідування.
I don't have every detail about this investigation.
Тому я не хотів би його коментувати, бо ці слова можуть бути використані для маніпуляцій.
That's why I wouldn't share any comments right now about that, because my words could be used for manipulative purposes.
В той же час, що я можу сказати на цю тему, що я абсолютно переконаний в тому, що президент Зеленський точно не буде частиною якихось маніпулятивних історій, маніпулятивних ігор політичних. І тому в мене немає жодного сумніву в тому, що яким би не було розслідування по цій компанії, в ньому не буде політичного втручання.
On the other hand, I'm still very convinced that President Zelensky will never be involved in any kind of stories, manipulative stories or games. And whatever the investigation produces and leads to, I'm sure President Zelensky will be out of this process.
We're coming to the end of our time, so I'm sorry there's not going to be time to take all of your questions, but I'll take two more and then ask the Prime Minister to answer them together. Gentlemen there. Microphone coming.
Thank you very much for your speech and welcome to London. I'd just like, my name is John Gawthrop. I work for Argus Media. I'd like to ask you about gas supplies. Do you think that there's any chance of an agreement being reached between Russia and Ukraine over transit of Russian gas through Ukraine to Europe by the end of this year. And as a sort of supplement to that, I know that Russia has linked the question of gas transit to supply of supposedly cheap gas to Ukraine. Is Ukraine interested in buying Russian gas in the future, given that you've actually gone?
Can I just take another question, then we'll come back to that. Here, please. In the second row.
Thomas Simon-Laritas, Mercury. Mr. Prime Minister, Alexei, I think your premiership enjoys tremendous support internationally, as well as your government. The main concern is about the influence of the vested interest, not so much on your government, but on the judiciary. And the non-reform of the judiciary has been the biggest failure of the previous administration. And there's been a text that has been proposed recently that didn't meet a lot of positive welcome internationally. So my question is, how will you be addressing this issue that could undermine a lot of things, not just for your government, but also FDI, the IMF, as we're seeing it as well?
Для початку про транзит газу. Переговори тривають.
Yes, the talks are still on.
І тут є дві важливі частини.
And there are two major parts here that have to be mentioned.
Частина перша. Україна хоче і буде, і має намір адаптувати свої правила до європейських. Ну, тобто, євроінтегруватися тут.
Well, Ukraine is willing and will intend to actually have integrated all the rules and procedures in accordance with those European standards.
Тому за останні три місяці ми зробили в цьому напрямку більше роботи, ніж за останні там роки було зроблено.
So we've done much more in the last three months than anything that had been done years before that.
Зараз наш у нас в Україні створюється незалежний оператор, який може керувати газотранспортною системою відповідно до європейських правил. Тому до кінця року з української сторони ми будемо абсолютно готові до підписання контрактів на європейських за європейськими правилами.
So because we are establishing an independent gas transit operator, that's why this company will be independent and fully in charge of the Ukraine's gas transit system. And I'm sure by the end of this year, Ukraine will be ready to start signing the contracts for the supplies of natural gas in full accordance with European standards.
Друга частина відповіді про те, чи буде досягнена угода.
The second part of the question is whether the agreement can be reached.
І тут, звичайно, я не можу робити таких конкретних прогнозів, тому що підписання угоди залежить від двох сторін.
And here again, it's very difficult, and I just can't make any forecasts because the success of signing such an agreement depends very much on the two parties, the two sides.
Але що важливо тут розуміти?
But what's important to understand here, however?
На мою думку, на цю угоду потрібно дивитися не як на угоду між Україною і Російською Федерацією.
I'm sure this agreement does not have to be looked at as purely the agreement between Ukraine and Russia.
На мою думку, на цю угоду потрібно дивитися як на угоду, яка забезпечує енергетичну безпеку Європи в тому числі.
It should be looked at as the contract that actually ensures European energy security.
Тому що такі проекти, як, наприклад, Nord Stream 2, які, на нашу думку, є політичними, а не економічними.
Because such projects as the Nord Stream 2, which, to my mind, is very much political and not that much economic.
Демонструють, що Російська Федерація намагається і буде намагатися створювати у себе всі інструменти для того, щоб мати важелі впливу, важелі тиску, в тому числі на європейські держави.
It actually shows that the Russian Federation has been doing and will continue to create so many different tools to have enough leverage on not only Ukraine, but also in the European market.
Тому диверсифікація поставок газу в Європу, на мою особисту думку, це питання енергетичної безпеки і України, і Європи.
That's why diversification of energy supplies to Europe is an issue of the European energy security.
Тому в цій угоді заінтересована не лише Україна, в цій угоді заінтересований Європейський Союз.
That's why it's not only Ukraine that is interested in such a contract, but those are the EU member states that are stakeholders to it.
І тому не випадково, що цей архітектура переговорів, вона також за участі європейців.
And it's not an accident that this entire architecture of those negotiations involve many European actors.
Я думаю, що спільні зусилля цілком можуть привести нас до бажаного результату.
I'm sure with a joint effort we might ultimately reach the result that everybody will be happy about.
Приховані інтереси, про vested interests.
With regards to the vested interests question.
Система правосуддя, вона складається з декількох важливих елементів.
You know, the system of justice is composed of several very important integral parts.
І окремі елементи, великі елементи, важливі елементи цієї системи уже контролюються урядом.
And some of those important parts of the system are already under the governmental control.
Наприклад, система примусового виконання судових рішень.
For instance, the system of enforcing court rulings.
Наприклад, система реєстрації прав власності.
Or property rights registration.
Наприклад, система виконання покарань.
Or actually the system of execution.
Це все це все частини нашого Міністерства юстиції.
All those parts are pretty much looked and over by our Ministry of Justice.
Я вже казав про те, що у нас чудова команда в Міністерстві юстиції.
And like I said, we have a really, really team of champions there in the Ministry of Justice.
Тому прогрес в цій сфері, наприклад, за останні два місяці, він вже, його не можна не помічати, він вже дуже серйозний.
That's why, like I said, the progress the ministry has achieved in the last couple of months is really incredible, and that's really noticeable.
Тому в цій частині у нас уже наводиться порядок, ми вже маємо серйозні здобутки.
So we already put things into order, and we already can share some of the achievements there.
Як я вже сказав, у нас завершується створення антикорупційної системи також, архітектури.
Like I said, we're about to complete our anti-corruption infrastructure already.
Так, наприклад, два місяці назад запрацював антикорупційний суд.
And two months ago we kick-started the work of the High Anti-Corruption Court.
За ці два місяці Верховна Рада проголосувала зняття депутатської недоторканності.
Actually, over the last two months the parliament voted for actually lifting immunity for the people's deputies, for the members of the Ukrainian parliament.
Повернула відповідальність за незаконне збагачення офіційних high officials.
And we actually brought back liability for illicit gains by high officials.
Перезавантажила національне агентство запобігання корупції.
We have actually reloaded the national agency on the prevention of corruption as well.
А ми в уряді вибрали таку дуже репутаційну з порядних, чесних, професійних людей комісію, яке мають обрати керівника цього агенції.
And we in government have selected the highly reputable board that will be actually working on selecting the chairperson for this organization.
Був прийнятий закон, який перезавантажує, дає можливість перезавантажити частину судової системи.
Actually, an important law was passed to actually help reform the judiciary.
У нас молодий, чесний генеральний прокурор, який перезавантажує Генеральну прокуратуру.
We have a young and a very professional prosecutor general that is working very hard on this anti-corruption reform as well.
Всі ці дуже конкретні кроки за останні буквально там два місяці переконують мене, тобто в мене немає сумніву, що вони приведуть до своїх результатів.
All those decisive steps that have taken place over the last couple of months have made me convinced that we're doing the right thing and we're on the right track.
Але, звичайно, нам потрібен якийсь час.
But of course this takes time.
І поки у нас ще є потреба, як у уряду, спілкуватися індивідуально з кожним інвестором і розглядати кожен конкретний кейс, кейс-бай-кейс.
So we still sometimes have to be talking to every individual investor and actually handle those individual cases of those investors.
Тобто, наша стратегія полягає в тому, щоб будувати сильні спроможні інститути.
So our strategy is about building strong and capable institutions, therefore.
Але наша тактика – не давати корупціонерам жодного шансу прямо зараз.
But our tactic, however, is to not to leave any chance for those corrupt people anywhere in Ukraine.
Prime Minister, thank you very much indeed. Thank you for your generosity with your time answering questions. I'm sorry we couldn't get round to everybody's questions. Thank you, all of you, for coming. Could I ask you, please, just to stay in your seats for a couple of moments while the Prime Minister leaves the room?